20-kilogram mass fastened to a light spring, spring constant 380 newtons per meter, passes over a pulley as shown. The pulley is frictionless, and the mass is released from rest when the spring is unstretched. After the mass has dropped 0.1 meters, what is the speed? So we have a situation like this. The spring, pulley, mass up here. We're told the spring constant is 380 newtons per meter. Down the distance, people know 0.4 meters, which means since it's connected to the spring would have stretched that same amount. So our stretch in the spring would also be 0.4 meters. And then at this time, this mass will have some velocity. It has velocity of 10 V. So this is a situation V. That's what we're looking at. We want to find out what that speed is after it's dropped to 0.4 meters. So I'm going to use conservation of energy, that conservation of energy equation. Say if the energy in A was any work done on the system, should equal the energy of B. Of course, in this case, there is no work on, no external force on the system, so no work done on the system, so let's just get rid of that. And we'll say if the kinetic energy in A plus potential energy in A should equal the kinetic energy of B. Of any of these terms are zero? Kinetic energy at A. We're going to start from rest, so we'll have no velocity at A. So this term is zero. Anything else? That might be it. What I might possibly do, though, what might be my next step? I'll just walk around. What would be my next step? Two kinds of potential energy, right? In this case, do I worry about the spring potential energy for A? No. The spring was unstretched. I'm going to have to worry about it for B. Let's go then. Count it over here. 1/2 kx squared over here for B. mass and gravity is inside MGH, height of A, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to define my height of B as being 0. So we'll say at A we were above that by 0.4 meters. So this MG height of B is going to be 0. Is that true? And then, as Wes said, we want to define all the terms. And I have a kinetic energy at point B. In fact, it's going to be 1/2 mass times velocity of B squared. So there it is. We have the potential energy at A will equal the kinetic energy of B plus the potential energy of B. All the potential energy of B is going to be defined in terms of the stretch spread. I think I've got it all there. So we're going to solve this for the velocity of B. Subtracting 1/2 kinetic spread from both sides. 1/2 mass times velocity of B squared. So equal mg right at A minus 1/2 kinetic squared. Multiply both sides by 2, divide by the mass, the square root. So the velocity of B will be 2 mg right at A minus kinetic squared, divided by the mass, square root. That's going to be 2 times 20 times 9.8 times 0.4 minus 380 times 0.4 squared, because x is the same as the strip of the spring as much as we fell. Everything's connected. Over 20 square root. You didn't bring a calculator today. So what's the answer supposed to be? 2.2. Take a look at number 21. So the 10 kilogram object is dropped from rest. After falling a distance of 50 meters, it has a speed of 26 meters per second. How much work is done by the dissipative air resistive force on the object during this time? An object has a mass of 10 kilograms. It's going to fall 50 meters. At which point it'll have some speed equal to 26 meters per second. Now, along the way, there's going to be a resistive force on it against its motion. It could be air friction. Air friction working against it. We want to find the work done by that resistive force along the way. Any ideas? Basketball. line this level to zero. A will be where I started, set your equation. We'll say that energy at A is any work done along the way equals the energy at B. So I think I'll just go ahead and expand this equation. We'll say the kinetic energy at A is potential energy at A is any work done along the way equals kinetic energy at B plus potential energy at B. The question is, what is the work done by friction during the descent? Friction is going to be our only external force in this case. So, essentially, we just want to find that, the work done on the system. All right, it's going to be something. That's all we don't even have to know what the frictional force is, the distance, because they're just asked for the work done by friction. So we're just going to find that. We just need to evaluate these other terms. Which of these other terms might be zero? Kinetic energy at A and potential energy at B. Kinetic energy at A because we started at best. Potential energy at B because we defined that level as zero. There's no springs involved. So we set that to be zero. So rearranging this equation, working on the system, equals the kinetic energy at B minus the potential energy at A. So work on the system will equal 1/2 the mass times the velocity of B squared minus the potential energy at A, which would just be mgh. Mg, height of A. I think we just need to put the values in. So we have 1/2 times 10 kilograms, velocity of B was 26, minus 10 times 9.8 times 50. And I remembered everything this morning, including the basketball, except my calculator. So, maybe somebody else can do the calculation for me. Thank you. All right, so let me try this. -1,520 joules. Friction, it did negative work. So -1.5 kilojoules, I guess would be the answer. So what's it say? Good? Look at 22. The block shown is released from the rest of the spring and stretch a distance d. It pays 50 newtons per meter. The mass is 0.5 kilograms and the distance is 10 centimeters. And the coefficient of friction between the block and the horizontal surface is equal to 0.25. Determine the speed of the block when it first passes through the position for which the spring is unstretched. Block attached to the spring. Spring constant is 50 newtons per meter. And the mass of the block is 0.5 kilograms. And it's been stretched, this is D. Equal to 10 centimeters or 0.1 meter. And there's a coefficient of kinetic friction between the block and the horizontal surface. And that's equal to 0.25. Frictional force will equal 25% of the normal force. We want to find the speed of the block when it first passes through the equilibrium position. So there will be some frictional force on this block at this point. We'll call this situation A. And I'm assuming we're starting to pass together. And so sometime later, the block's going to be here. The spring will be unstretched at that moment, and the block will be moving to the left here. And that'll be situation B, like that. So we're going to set up our equation, one equation. So say that the energy in A, plus any work done on the system, should equal the energy in B. So say kinetic energy in A, plus potential energy in A, plus any work done on the system, will equal the kinetic energy in B, plus potential energy in B. Which, if any of these terms are zero? Kinetic energy at B? Oh, okay. Kinetic energy at A and potential energy at B because we start from rest. Still kinetic energy to begin with. And potential energy at B because the spring is no longer stretched at that moment. So we have no gravitational potential energy to worry about. Spring energy. And we start off with spring energy, but at point B is zero. Alright, I think that's it. So our potential energy at A will be 1/2 kx squared. So we'll have a, let me write it out. We're going to have 1/2 kx squared here. Work done on the system. I'm going to write that. We definitely have work done on this system. There's an external force. F times D. Positive or negative? Negative. It's going against the motion. So we're going to have a negative force times distance here. F being the frictional force against the motion. That's going to equal 1/2. Mass times velocity of B squared. Look good? We were given the coefficient of friction, which means that the frictional force will equal that coefficient of friction times the normal force. What's the normal force in this case? Mg. Because if we were to do a free body diagram, we'd have a normal force and an mg vertically, and so the normal force will equal mg. So in this case, this frictional force will equal mu times mg. And that's what I'm going to put in there. So now my equation is looking like this. 1/2 kx squared. Minus mu mg times d equals 1/2 mass times velocity of b. Can't get rid of the mass because I have that 1/2 kx squared. divide by the mass, take the square root. So the velocity of B, away from all, kx squared minus 2 mu mgd, divided by the mass, square root. So that will be 50 times 0.1 squared minus 2 times 0.25 times the mass, 0.5 times 9.8 times the distance d, 0.1 over the mass, 0.5, all that, square root. I got 0.714 meters per second. Which I guess I could write at 71.4 centimeters per second. If I want to find an answer on the sheet that corresponds to my answer. Doesn't feel like it gives you a little bit of power? I mean, because it's like everyday situations, okay? You can solve. Gives you a little power to solving problems of nature. All right, let's try one more of these. Well, maybe two more. Take a look at 24. The 1.2 kilogram mass is projected up a rough circular track with radius of 0.8 meters, as shown. The speed of the mass at point A is 8.4 meters per second. At point B, it's 5.6 meters per second. How much work is done on the mass between A and B by the force of friction? Here's a circular track, the radius 0.8 meters. And down here, that cart moving with some velocity 8.4 meters per second, so in this point A. So the velocity at A is 8.4 meters per second. And when it finally reaches point B up here, it's got a velocity of B equal to 5.6 meters per second. And the question is, if the mass is 0.2 kilograms, how much work was done by friction along the way between A and B? So I'm going to set up my equation. I'm going to say that the energy at A plus the work done on the system equals the energy at B. I'll just go one step further. I'll say the kinetic energy at A plus potential energy at A plus any work done along the way equals kinetic energy at B plus potential energy at B. Help? me out with these terms. This first thing is, is anything of zero? Potential energy at A. Because we'll define a level at A to be our zero height. Anything else? Good answer. Nothing else. So we got all these other terms. We want to find the work done by friction. So again, in this particular case, we don't have to figure out friction or mu or anything else. We're asked for the work done by friction. So we'll just solve for the work on the system because friction is the only external force in this case. So we'll say that the work done on the system is equal to kinetic energy of B plus potential energy of B minus the kinetic energy of A. So we'll say that this is equal to 1/2 the mass times the velocity of B squared plus potential energy at B will just be mgh, where h is your height at B, minus 1/2 the mass times velocity of A squared. So this 1/2 times 1.2, velocity at B squared was 5.6. 1.2 times 9.8 times the height at B minus 1/2 times 1.2 times 8.4 squared. I put everything in there with the height at B. What is the height at B?
1.6.
The radius of the circle is 0.8. Purposely wrote it this way, but if you think of this circle is going around here, then your height is going to be the diameter of that circle. So your height is going to be 1.6 meters. Very good. Let's put in those values. Somebody gets it before I do. Please call it out. Negative 4.7. Oh, 4. Sounds good, right? All right, I can say that for another day. I think that's good enough for chapter 8, you think? Real quickly at a couple problems from the chapter 9 handout, these two that are pertinent to what we're talking about. Last time we introduced a concept called momentum. We said that momentum is a vector. Mass times velocity of something. If we only look at it in a linear sense, then we can just look at it like this: momentum equals mass times velocity. And we can think of if something were to change momentum from one point to another, we could say it's change in momentum equals mass times final velocity minus its mass times its initial velocity. The final momentum minus the initial. And idea of impulse is that if you do have a change in momentum taking place caused by impulse, impulse is an average force applied for a certain amount of time. And these are inversely proportional given a certain amount of momentum change. So that if your time interval gets really short, your average force gets really large and vice versa. You can increase the time, and you can reduce the force for a given momentum change. I think basically that's what we did. Take a look at the number one on this handout. It says a 1.2 kilogram object moving with speed of 8 meters per second glides perpendicularly to the wall and emerges with a speed of 6 meters per second in the opposite direction. If the object is in contact with the wall for 2 milliseconds, what is the magnitude of the average force on the object by the wall? Try this. We've got a mass, 1.2 kilograms, moving at 8 meters per second. So initial velocity is 8 meters per second. It's going to hit a wall, bounce off the wall, and come back. And the final velocity is 6 meters per second. Look good?
Should be negative, right?
Should be negative. I mean, look at things in a linear sense, then if I define one direction as positive, the other direction should be negative. Good. And the contact with the wall is 2 milliseconds. So using this last formula right here, well, let's figure out the change in momentum. Let's do that. Our change in momentum is going to equal our final momentum minus our initial momentum. That's going to equal the mass times the final velocity minus the mass times the initial velocity. So that'll be the mass, 1.2, times the final velocity, which is a negative 6. Minus the initial velocity, which is 8. So it's going to be 1.2 times a negative 14. Which is a negative 16.8 kilogram meters per second. Impulse should equal change in momentum. So our impulse, which is the average force times time, should equal the change in momentum. So our average force of the wall will equal the change in momentum or the change in time. And that's going to equal a negative 16.8 kilogram meters per second over 2 milliseconds. 3 times 10 to the minus 3. So I get negative 8,400 units. Negative just because this force would be going in the negative direction. And when this ball hits the wall, it's being contacted by the wall. The wall is exerting a force in the negative direction, negative 8,400 newtons. The question was asking for the magnitude of that force. So the question just wanted to know what is the magnitude, not whether it was positive or negative, but absolute value. So it would be 8,400 newtons or 8.4 kilonewtons, and our answer would be. One more. Look at number two. A 2.4 kilogram ball falling vertically hits the floor with a speed of 2.5 meters per second and rebounds with a speed of 1.5 meters per second. What is the magnitude of the impulse exerted on the ball by the floor? So here we have a ball that's about to hit the floor. Its initial velocity is 2.5 meters per second. Does that look good? Depends on what you define as positive. I'm actually going to just say that up is positive on this one. Let's just go and say that that's a negative 2.5 meters per second. I don't have to do that. I could just say down is positive. That's fine. Rebounds, so our final velocity is going up, and that would be then a positive 1.5 meters per second. Mass of the ball is 2.4 kilograms. We want to find the magnitude of the impulse exerted on the ball by the floor. Well, change of momentum is actually equal to the impulse. And that's equal to mass times the final velocity minus mass times the initial velocity. So that's equal to the mass, 2.4, times the final velocity, 1.5, minus the initial velocity, negative 2.5. It's actually going to be 1.5 plus 2.5, which would be 4 times 2.4, which would give us 9.6 kilogram meters per second, or 4 newton seconds, right? This kind of real key thing right here is this minus minus here. Because you think that if it hits the floor, it's going to take a certain amount of impulse just to stop it from keeping on going. And then a little bit more impulse to actually push it back in the opposite direction. So you have to think that it's going to take more impulse than just to stop it to actually reverse its direction. And hence, that's where this actually comes in play, is that this is going to actually add here instead of subtract. Okay, let's take a look at something new or slightly different. We want to use this idea of momentum for situations. And one possible situation is what we call an inelastic collision. Think about what we're going to do with this. First of all, we're going to have a collision between two objects. And we're going to make an approximation here. When this collision occurs, going to happen over a very short time period. We're going to say that that as this collision occurred between these two objects, it was going to be a very short time involved during that collision. And since in our definition of impulse, we said that change in momentum was equal to average force times change in time. So if there's going to be a change in momentum of these two objects caused by impulse between them, and the time interval is really short, then the forces between these two objects is really large, right? So given that the shorter the time interval in the collision, the larger the forces are between the two objects themselves. Now, if those forces between the two objects are really large, then all other forces in the external world are small in comparison. Think about it. These forces are really large on this collision, maybe on the order of thousands of newtons or something, then gravity is really small in comparison. So the weight of the two objects is really small compared to those forces. Friction is really small in comparison. Any other normal external forces are really small in comparison. Hence, I can say that as these two things collide, the forces that really matter are the forces between the two of them. All other external forces are really small. And for that moment, then, I can say that this system is isolated. Okay? For all practical purposes, it's isolated. And we said last time, if a system is isolated, where only the internal forces are involved, no external forces, then momentum is conserved. So we're going to call this thing that happens when these two collide and the time interval is shorter, we're going to call that the impulse approximation. We're going to say, because this impulse is over such a short time, forces are so large between the two objects, external forces can be ignored, the system is isolated, momentum should be conserved. The shorter the impact, the better that approximation is. That's pretty neat, because then we can use this conservation of momentum idea. So momentum is conserved. Unfortunately, for most collisions, kinetic energy would not be conserved. So momentum will be conserved, but due to internal forces, you know, if this is being compressed, this is being compressed, and from the different elasticity and possibly heat and some friction and other things going on, we are going to lose kinetic energy. But momentum will be conserved because of the short time period. In fact, for all the collisions that we're going to deal with, we're going to assume momentum is conserved. So for every problem that we're going to deal with from now on in this chapter, one thing you can always be sure of is momentum will be conserved. We're going to have what we call a perfectly inelastic collision. An inelastic collision, then, is one where momentum is conserved. That's the collision to begin with. But what will define an inelastic collision is that kinetic energy is not conserved. So we're actually going to lose some energy due to that collision. So that would be an inelastic collision. It's possible that we could have a collision which is perfectly inelastic. In that collision, these two objects will hit, and they'll stick together after the collision and move together as essentially one body with one velocity after the collision. Right? Most collisions might not be that way. You might have a collision that's inelastic, kinetic energy was lost, but they'll go their separate ways. But if it's perfectly inelastic, they'll collide, stick together, and move together after the collision. So it might look like this. Two objects moving towards each other with their initial velocities. After the collision, they stick together, move with one common final velocity. If I were to write the conservation of momentum for this situation, I'd say the total momentum beforehand, mass times velocity initial for particle 1 plus mass times velocity initial for particle 2, total momentum beforehand should equal the total momentum afterwards, which is total mass times final velocity. If I wrote it that way, I would say that my final velocity will equal my initial momentum, mass times velocity initial for both particles, divided by the total mass. So this would be my final velocity of the system. I can solve for that. We'll note that when we're putting in these variables, it is possible, since we're looking at a linear line here, where one direction is defined to be positive and the other direction is negative, that for these velocities, it's possible you might have a negative number of one or two of those velocities. And in this particular case, as I've drawn this, V2 initial would be a negative value that would go into this equation. Here's an example. Here we have a car collision. An SUV collides with a compact car. An SUV with a mass of 1,800 kilograms is traveling eastbound at 15 meters per second, while a compact car with a mass of 900 kilograms is traveling westbound at minus 15 meters per second. The cars collide head-on, becoming entangled. What is the speed of the entangled cars right after the collision? Well, we can always write down our conservation of momentum equation, which would be look like this for every collision that we're going to deal with. So we'd say the mass times velocity for car 1 plus the mass times velocity for car 2 initially should equal the mass times velocity for car 1 plus the mass times velocity for car 2 finally. In this particular case, they're going to stick together after the collision, so they're going to move with a common final velocity. So I can just, the right-hand side of that equals, I can just write as mass 1 plus mass 2 times final velocity. And over on the left, we have the SUV, 1,800 kilograms times 15 meters per second, plus 900 kilograms times negative 15 meters per second is our initial momentum. Solving for the final velocity then, we have 13,500 kilogram meters per second over 2,700 kilograms, plus 5 meters per second, which means the SUV won, sort of. So we end up both cars moving to the right at 5 meters per second. How much kinetic energy was lost in this perfectly inelastic collision? Perfectly inelastic because they stuck together. Well, let's look at the kinetic energy initially. That would be the kinetic energy of the SUV, the first car, 1/2 mass times velocity squared for it, plus kinetic energy of this of the compact car, 1/2 mv squared for it initially. Let's put in our values. We're moving at 15 meters per second for both. Note that even though the compact car had a negative 15 meters per second, in terms of kinetic energy, that's a positive value. Negative 15 squared will be positive, and you always will be dealing with positive kinetic energies. So they both had energy to add to the equation. So we started off with 303,750 joules of energy. After the collision, our kinetic energy would be 1/2 mv squared for both cars after the collision. They have the same velocity afterwards. So that's going to be 1/2 the total mass times their common velocity squared, 5 meters per second squared. That's only 33,750 joules. $30,000. So we lost 270,000 joules in the collision, which is about 89% of the kinetic energy. So kinetic energy was not conserved. Lost approximately 90% of kinetic energy. Where did it go? Heat's the best one. Deformation of the cars, you know, the destruction, the heat, mostly heat, and eventually everything goes to heat. So momentum was conserved, kinetic energy was not. Look at this example. Here's another perfectly inelastic collision. So it's actually a device that we're going to use. It's a ballistic pendulum. In this situation, we're going to have a block of wood that's going to be suspended by wires, and we're going to shoot a bullet into this block of wood. And it's going to be a perfectly inelastic collision because the bullet's going to get lodged in the block. So the two objects are going to stick together, per se, after the collision. So by shooting the bullet into the block, the two will move together and swing up to some height after the collision. I'll read it this way. Ballistic pendulum is a system used to measure the speed of a fast-moving projectile, such as a bullet. The bullet is fired into the large block of wood suspended from some light wires. The bullet is then stopped by the block, and the entire system swings through a height H. We're going to use our principles of conservation, first for momentum and then conservation of energy, to figure out what the speed of the bullet was. We're going to assume that the contact time between these two objects is so fast that the impulse approximation is valid, which makes sense. So that momentum will be conserved on the collision, inelastic collision of the bullet with the block. Well, the initial momentum of this system was all provided by the bullet itself. The block was stationary, so it had no velocity to begin with. So our initial momentum was the mass times velocity of the bullet. Our final momentum is the two of them together, the total mass times their final velocity immediately after the collision. It's a perfectly inelastic collision. So we could say that the initial velocity of the bullet is equal to the total mass of the bullet plus the block divided by the mass of the bullet times the final velocity right after the collision. This would help us find the velocity of the bullet if we knew what the final velocity right after the collision was, but we don't know that. We do know that right after the collision, the bullet-block combination swung up to a height H. So we could use conservation of energy to figure out what that velocity was right after collision, because all that kinetic energy after the collision that was conserved and transferred into potential energy of height for the bullet-block combination together. So we know from conservation of energy that right after the collision, we had 1/2 mass times velocity squared. The kinetic energy of the bullet-block was transferred into mgh for the bullet plus block. And actually, the masses cancel out on these. So the final velocity should equal the square root of 2gh. We've seen that before. It's kind of the reverse situation. We're starting with the velocity down here, and we end up momentarily at rest at some height h. So that velocity should equal the square root of 2gh. plug that into the previous formula, and now we have that the velocity of the bullet initially should equal the total mass, bullet plus block, over the mass of the bullet, over the square root of 2dh, where h was the height that the bullet block combination swung up to. So if I had a good camera, and I marked how high this bullet block combination went, I could measure that distance, that height, plug it into this formula, knowing what the masses of the two constituents were, and I could get the velocity of the bullet. Let's try it out. In a ballistic pendulum experiment, suppose that it swung up 5 centimeters, the mass of the bullet was 5 grams, and the mass of the block was 1 kilogram. Find the initial speed of the projectile. Well, initial speed should equal, in this formula, the total mass over the mass of the bullet, square root of 2gh. Put in our values, the mass of the bullet was 5 grams, and that's 0.005 kilograms. The mass of the block is 1 kilogram. We swung up 5 centimeters, that's going to be 0.05 meters. And so the velocity of the bullet turns out to be 199 meters per second. Be approximately 440 miles per hour. That's extremely fast for a bullet. Find the loss of energy due to the collision. Initially, all the energy was provided by the bullet. So our initial energy is 1/2 mass times the initial velocity of the bullet squared. And then our final energy is the potential energy of the bullet block combination, MGH, for the two of them. If we put in the numbers for that, we'll get 99 joules minus about half a joule, or 98.5 joules. So we lost 98.5 joules of our original 99 joules. And again, all that energy went into probably heat and deformation of the block, and possibly the bullet too. The bullet's going to have some scratches on it as well. All right, so we've used this conservation of momentum idea for what we call an inelastic collision. Inelastic collision is one where momentum is conserved, but kinetic energy is not conserved. Well, there's another kind of collision that we may consider, and that is called an elastic collision. An elastic collision is a very clean one. And I wish I had brought another tennis ball, because you probably want to demonstrate this with two equal objects. But in an elastic collision, and elastic collision, the collision would be very clean. They would hit, bounce off, and they would leave. And the energy, the kinetic energy they started with as a whole, will equal the kinetic energy they end up with. So very clean. Almost, well, no loss of energy due to the collision itself. So two things are conserved. Momentum is always conserved, but in this case, kinetic energy would also be conserved. Example, closest example on the macroscopic scale might be a billiard ball collision. You're playing pool and you got two objects of the same mass, and they collide with very little indentation, and they actually bounce back to the original shape, and everything's perfect. You might say that that's very close to being an elastic collision, in which the energy they had right before the collision equals the energy they have right afterwards, even though eventually those balls are going to stop because you're going to have friction afterwards and take away their energy. But as the collision is concerned, it's very fast, very clean, and very close to being elastic, but not quite elastic. In fact, anything in the macroscopic world would not be, I mean, not be a last, because you would, you only approach that. Another example would be air molecule collisions with walls. Right now there's air molecules flying around, they're colliding with walls, and that's very close, if not exactly lasting, because those molecules bounce against the walls. So here's our constraining features for an elastic collision. The momentum is conserved, as always. Momentum equals, before equals momentum afterwards. In this case, kinetic energy is conserved as well. It might look something like this. There are two objects colliding, mass one, mass two. Afterwards, they bounce off cleanly. Kinetic energy is conserved. I would write the momentum conservation like I did before. Mass times velocity for both objects beforehand equals mass times velocity for both objects afterwards. But now I would also write conservation of kinetic energy. And I'd say 1/2 mass times velocity squared initially for particle 1 plus 1/2 mv squared for particle 2. That's my initial kinetic energy. That quantity should equal my final kinetic energy, 1/2 mv squared. Particle 1 plus 1/2 mv squared for particle 2, final. So for an elastic collision, both of these should be true. Let's start with this momentum conservation equation. That should be true. I'm going to rearrange that. I'm going to subtract mass 1 times velocity 1 final from both sides, and subtract the mass 2 times velocity 2 initial from both sides, just so I can get all the mass 1 terms on the left, all the mass 2 terms on the right. And factor out mass 1 and factor out mass 2, so I get this nice equation. Mass 1 times velocity 1 initial minus velocity 1 final equals mass 2, velocity 2 final, minus velocity 2 initial. I'm going to call that equation number 1. Not any kind of equation that you want to save, but I'm headed somewhere with this. Now we're going to write down the other equation that is valid for this collision. That is conservation of kinetic energy. So I'm going to write that down in its entirety. I'm going to rearrange that so it has all its mass 1 terms on the left and all its mass 2 terms on the right. So I multiply by 2, get rid of the 1/2, and then above the mass 1, velocity 1 final squared over to the left-hand side, and do the same thing with mass 2, velocity 2 initial squared to the right-hand side. I'm going to factor out the masses, and also factor the difference of squares. So I have the difference of squares, velocity 1 initial minus velocity 1 final. That's the same as velocity 1 initial minus velocity 1 final times velocity 1 initial plus velocity 1 final. So I'm just factoring the difference of squares on the left, and I did the same thing with the difference of squares on the right. So this I'm going to call equation number 2. Now we have this elastic collision. Both these equations are valid for this elastic. They must be true if we have a truly elastic collision. If I look at this equation up here, equation number 1, I would find that mass 1 times velocity 1 initial minus velocity 1 final, that term right there looks just like the beginning of this equation down here, right there. And if I look at the right-hand side, that equals mass 2 times velocity 2 final minus velocity 2 initial. That looks like that part of the second equation right there. So if this equals this, and that equals that, I can take that equals that, divide by this equals this, and come up with something. Come up with this and that. If this is equal to this, side of that, and that is, this is equal to this here. This and that, and this and that. I'll divide the equal amount over there, so I can get rid of this blue and the red. Circle it. Right? Because they're equal to each other. So I come up with this. Velocity 1 initial plus velocity 1 final equals velocity 2 initial plus velocity 2 final. A neat little equation describes elastic collisions. In other words, the sum of velocity for particle 1, initial and final, equals the sum of velocities for particle 2, initial and final. For instance, if I had two billiard balls of the same mass, and they were to hit and collide, what this is saying is the initial velocity of particle 1 plus its final velocity should equal the initial velocity of particle 2 plus its final velocity. Now, if particle 2 happened to be at rest, and the first ball came in, what's going to happen? Well, the first ball might stop, and the second ball will continue on. If it's perfectly elastic, then the second ball will continue on with the velocity of the first ball. So they'll collide like this. And I really should use two equal tennis balls for this, but they'll collide like this, and this will go on with the same velocity. The sum of the velocity before for one particle, or before and after for one particle, will equal the sum of the velocity before and after. Here's some general formula, which I'm not going to derive for you because it would take quite a while. It's just a lot of algebra, actually. But here's a general formula. In general, if you happen to know what the initial velocities of the two particles are beforehand, you can solve for the final velocities of the two particles. And so the final velocity of particle 1 would equal this. Mass 1 minus mass 2, or mass 1 plus mass 2, times the initial velocity of particle 1, plus 2 times mass 2, or mass 1 plus mass 2, times the initial velocity of particle 2. So if I happen to know what happened initially, and there was an elastic collision, this would give me the final velocity of particle 1. And for that matter, here's the final velocity of particle 2, if I happen to know the initial velocity. Only for an elastic collision where the momentum and kinetic energy are conserved. Only for that. But these are two formulas that I would like you to have on your formula card for the next test. They're nice little formulas. If you know your initial velocities, plug them into this formula and get your final velocities. Now, possibly that these initial velocities, one or both of them could be negative, depending on what you define as the positive or negative direction. So remember that. If one of the two masses happen to be at rest to begin with, let's say mass 2 were at rest, then velocity 2 initial would be 0. And this formula would simplify your second terms here would be lopped off. And you'd be truncated to just your initial your first terms there. So it looks something like this. Velocity 1 final would simplify to just the first term. And velocity 2 final would simplify to just the first term. If the second particle starts at rest. And here you can see then that if I use that billiard ball situation, if the two were of equal mass and they were to hit, and the second one was at rest to begin with, then you can see if I plug in here, mass 1 is the same as mass 2, then that final velocity of particle 1 would be 0, because mass times mass minus mass would be 0. And my final velocity particle two would be 2m over 2m, which is 1. So final velocity particle 2 would just equal the initial velocity particle 1. So as this one comes in, its velocity is transferred to particle 2. Final velocity particle 2 is equal to the initial velocity of particle 1. And then this equals the initial velocity of particle 2, and then it ends up at rest. Here's another situation. Let's say the second particle is at rest, but a relatively light particle strikes a considerably heavy particle at rest. So here's our second particle, it's at rest. I have a light particle coming in, it's going to hit this big particle. What's going to happen with it? And the last collision between these two? Well, according to formulas, if mass 2 is a lot bigger than mass 1, then if I look at that first formula, and I didn't bring my pointer to you, so those two things I forgot. If I look at that first formula, mass 2 is a lot bigger than mass 1, so in the numerator of that fraction, we could say mass 1 is insignificant. And same thing in the denominator. So we'd have a negative mass 2 over mass 2, which would be a negative 1, which means that the velocity 1 final equals a negative velocity 1 initial. That kind of makes sense, because if this is really large, and this is relatively small, and there's a last collision, this would hit, and the final velocity of this particle would equal the negative of its initial velocity. In other words, it would just bounce off. Comes in with initial velocity, final velocity. Let's look at the final velocity of particle 2. That is 2 times mass 1, which is mass 1 is really small compared to mass 2, over mass 1 plus mass 2. So you have something really small in the numerator over something infinitely large in the denominator. So that essentially would be 0. So we'd say that mass 2 starts at rest. We have this collision, mass 2 remains at rest. So the big ball acts like a wall. So it comes in, bounces off cleanly, and this just stays where it is. Well, you say, well, I knew that. And it's nice to know, but I know if I have a last collision throw something against a wall, it'll just come right back. Let's try this. Let's reverse the situation. Let's have a small particle initially at rest. Let's collide it with a large particle like this. What's going to happen in that case? In the last collision. Well, if mass 1 is a lot bigger than mass 2, then in the numerator of that first formula up there, we'll have mass 1 over mass 1, because mass 2 is insignificant compared to mass 1. Mass 2 is insignificant to mass 1. So we're going to have something really large over something really large, mass 1 over mass 1, essentially, which would be 1. So the final velocity of mass 1 will be equal to the initial velocity of mass 1. What that's saying is, if mass 1 comes in here with some velocity, hits mass 2, mass 1 is just going to continue on like nothing happened. Final velocity will equal its initial velocity. We said, that was nothing. Okay. Came on, nothing. What about mass 2, though? If I look at that formula of mass 2, velocity 2 final, that's going to equal 2 times mass 1, mass 1 is pretty significant, over mass 1 plus mass 2. Mass 1 is big compared to mass 2, so I essentially have 2 mass 1 over mass 1, which is 2. The final velocity of particle two is going to equal twice the velocity of particle one. That's an interesting result. I'm coming in with a velocity like this. It hits a small particle here. This takes off with twice the velocity that this had initially. That's pretty neat. Let's try this out. What I'm going to do is I'm going to drop this basketball to the floor, and then have the tennis ball on top of it. When it hits the floor, it's going to rebound from the floor, and then essentially, right after that, we're going to have close to an elastic collision with the basketball and the tennis ball. So the idea is if I do this, the tennis ball rebounds with twice the velocity as the basketball off the floor. If I really pump this basketball up, which I didn't, that's okay. Let's try that again. Let's see if I can. Actually, catch. NASA actually employs this technique. You know, if you want to go to Jupiter, say, Jupiter is 5 astronomical units away from the sun, so it's 5 times the distance that we are from the sun. It takes a long time to get there. And in fact, you know, you really can't imagine the amount of thrust it would require to shoot off the Earth and go straight to Jupiter just based on thrust. Because we want to get there at least within a few years, because, you know, we don't want to wait 30 years because, you know, we might have better technology by then. So we want to get there within a few years so that we can actually do some analysis. So what NASA will do is, first thing is to try to get away from Earth's gravity. So they'll have enough thrust to get away from Earth's gravity, but they might shoot, instead of right towards Jupiter, they might shoot towards Venus, say. They'll shoot at Venus, and essentially the spacecraft will have what you might consider an elastic collision with Venus. Venus is moving along. It's moving. It's traveling pretty fast through space, probably 30 kilometers per second, I guess. Really fast. And it's traveling around the sun in a Venus year, but it's traveling incredibly fast through space. So the spacecraft comes here and actually whips around Venus. But the essential idea is that it's going to bounce off Venus. Spacecraft comes in, bounces off, picks up not only the velocity of Venus, but twice the velocity of Venus. So it's free energy. It's stealing energy from Venus in order to pick up speed. And in fact, I think on the Cassini probe, which actually went to Saturn, what it is was shot at Venus, bounced off Venus, it came back to Earth, bounced off Earth, went back to Venus, bounced off Venus again, each time picking up speed, and then went off to Jupiter, picked up speed off of Jupiter, and then went off to Saturn. Right? And still took, 5 or 6 years to get there. But at least we got a lot of free energy out of it, picked up speed, and we're able to get there sooner so that we can actually do some studies in our lifetime. Try another demonstration. This is an interesting device. You probably know the name of this thing. You probably have a name for it. Do you? You've seen it before, right? What's the name that you know it by?
Newton's Cradle.
Newton's Cradle, yes. Very good. That is the technical name for this. I looked all around for a good one. I found this one at Maury's Gifts. I think it was the last one they had at the time. It cost me like $25. It's a good one. They did not call it Newton's Cradle. They called it Executive Stress Reliever. So I bought this Executive Stress Reliever. And the idea here is that we're actually going to have elastic collisions this executive stress reliever. For instance, if I have an elastic collision, both momentum and kinetic energy must be conserved. Now, if I take one ball out like this, what's going to happen? It's going to collide with these four balls down here, but I have to conserve both kinetic energy and momentum. Now, if I were only conserving momentum, it's possible I could come in with some speed with one ball, and those four balls would come off with 1/4 the speed. Right? If that's the only thing I was conserving was momentum, that's a possibility that would happen. However, if I have to conserve both momentum and kinetic energy going as 1/2 mass times velocity squared, I'm constrained to have only a certain type of thing happen. If I conserve both, if one ball goes in, one ball better come out. That is the only way that I could conserve both momentum and kinetic energy at the same time. I'm losing a little bit of energy on the collision because it is a macroscopic system. But basically, if I'm going to have an MV coming in, I've got an MV going out. But if I'm going to have a 1/2 MV squared coming in, I'm going to have a 1/2 MV squared coming out. There's no way that I could have one come in and conserve both momentum and kinetic energy with two coming out. I can't conserve both at the same time. So, if I pull two out like this, what do you expect is going to happen? The only way that I can conserve both momentum and kinetic energy in that direction is that if I pull two out like this, two better come out. Alright, that looks pretty good. Well, let's try this. If I pull three out, how am I possibly, with only two over there, how am I possibly going to conserve both momentum and kinetic energy at the same time? Well, if velocity goes higher, I might conserve momentum, but I won't be able to conserve kinetic energy. So if I pull three out like this, three better come out. So the middle one is exchanged. I got three coming down, three come out. That's the only way I can conserve both at the same time. Got the idea here, maybe? What happens if I pull four out like this? Same thing. If I pull four out like this, four must come out. To conserve both momentum and kinetic energy in that direction. $5. I gotta get my money's worth. So if I pull five out this way, there we go. Kinetic energy and momentum conserved. No collision, but conserved in both directions. Let's try something different. Let's say I pulled two out like this on both sides, and they're gonna collide in the middle like this. What do you expect is going to happen? I have two coming in, they're going to collide in the middle. What was that? Come, go back out? Is it possible that they could just stop? Then kinetic energy would not be conserved. Correct. Momentum would be conserved just like you might expect. Because if I pull two out like this, you see in the experiment today, and some of you do this experiment on Monday, that if you start out with zero momentum, you're going to end up with zero momentum. So if I have these two on both sides and they're both coming in like this, basically the momentum of that system is zero, right? Because I have a positive and a negative momentum. So it's possible in a momentum sense that they could hit and just stop because the final momentum would still be zero. But as Urban said, we have to conserve kinetic energy as well. So if they come in with 1/2 mv squared, which is positive for both of them, then we're going to conserve that as well. So they're going to have to hit and bounce off like this. Momentum will still be zero because they're going in opposite directions, but they will conserve back energy. And that's bounced off. What else can I do? We'll take three over here, two over there. Change the middle one for every collision. I think that's the limits of it's about $1 per demonstration. Because I've had a few demonstrations. There we go. Ultimately, though, I feel much relieved. It does its job, I think, after a while. Now let's try a Let's try one or two problems on the board concerning momentum. Look at number 6 on column 9 of that. The 2 kilogram object moving with a velocity of 5 meters per second in a positive x direction strikes and sticks to a 3 kilogram object moving with a speed of 2 meters per second in the same direction. How much kinetic energy is lost in this collision? Mass 1 is 2 kilograms, moving with a velocity of 5 meters per second, velocity 1 initial, 5 meters per second. It's going to collide with mass 2, which is 3 kilograms, moving with a velocity 2 initial, 2 meters per second. That's our initial state, like that. They're going to collide and stick together. So mass 1 and mass 2 will move together with some final velocity. So the question is, how much kinetic energy was lost in this collision? To figure out the kinetic energy lost, we're going to have to find out what that final velocity is so we can calculate the kinetic energy. And to find that final velocity, we're going to have to use conservation momentum. For all these collisions, that will apply. What kind of collision is this? Elastic or inelastic? It'll be an inelastic collision because we're actually going to lose kinetic energy. I can even clarify that even better. What kind of inelastic collision? Perfectly inelastic. It's going to be perfectly inelastic because they actually stick together. Alright, so first thing is momentum is conserved. Initial momentum will equal final momentum. Let me be rigorous here and say mass 1, velocity 1 initial plus mass 2, velocity 2 initial, which is the initial momentum of the system, will equal mass 1, velocity 1 final plus mass 2. Velocity 2 final momentum of the system. Even though I know that they're going to stick together and have the same final. this will be mass 1, 2 times 5 plus mass 2, which is 3 times velocity 2 initial equals 2 times velocity final plus 3 times velocity final. Same final velocity, so this can be equal to 5b final. So 5b final will equal 10 plus 6 or 16. B final equals 16 divided by 5 or 3.2 meters per second. So that's the final velocity of the two together after the collision. We were asked to find the kinetic energy lost. Well, let's find the initial kinetic energy first. Kinetic energy we start with was 1 half mv squared for both particles to begin with. That's 1 half mass 1, velocity 1 squared initially. That's 1 half mass 2, velocity 2 initial squared. So that's 1 half times 2 times 5 squared plus 1 half times 3 times 2 squared. So that's going to be 25 plus 6 is 31 joules. So we start with. And then what we end up with is 1 half the total mass times the final velocity squared, because they both are moving together. So that's going to be 1 half times 2 plus 3 times 3.2 squared. That's 2.5 times 3.2 squared. It's 25.6 joules. So the kinetic energy we lost is equal to the kinetic energy we started with minus the kinetic energy we ended up with. That's how much we lost. That's going to be 31 minus 25.6 or 5.4 joules. Sound good? I'm going to let you look at the rest of these and a couple of questions next Monday.